Psalm 33:11 says, "The counsel of the Lord stands forever, the plans of his heart to all generations."
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today. Good morning, Steve. How are you today?
A little older and a little creakier.
Uh-oh. That doesn't sound good.
Well, all flesh is grass. You know, that scripture and that one that he knows our frame, that we are like dust.
Yes. All too familiar with that.
Yeah. And then that verse that says, though our outward man is decaying. Mm-hmm. I feel that way. I've tried to deceive myself with thinking that I was still young, but I'm feeling my creakiness and age, and yet inside I'm good. So that's the comforting thought amongst all those other ones.
Well, hang in there.
Yeah.
We need you.
Well, I'm going to physical therapy as soon as I'm done here, try to get my shoulder and knee back in shape. How are you doing?
Oh, pretty good. I've got other ailments, but, you know, I'm in the same boat, so.
I know now how people can get together and just talk about your ailments. I think I could fill up a whole lunch hour just talking about the strategy. Okay, but today, this is actually part of the session. I just finished 41 studies on God's attributes, which are going into the book, Come Into His Presence, which is in the final stages of being proofed. My proofer is finishing college this week, and then she's going to jump in and finish those last couple. And it's a wonderful exercise to meditate and think about God's attributes. I know that we're a little bit ahead. Well, I think we're about 9 ahead of what are being produced and published on our website. But the most recent one is God is Faithful. And I just finished the transcript about God is the Great Initiator. And it's a wonderful job I have right now to fill up my mind with thinking about God and what he's like and the character qualities that he possesses. And when all around my soul gives way, so to speak, not only my physical condition, but we all have battles. It's called life. I still keep coming back to God. And one of the most comforting thoughts is what we're going to talk about today is that he never changes. The world changes. Our bodies change. Our circumstances change. The church changes. And painfully, I think probably to our chagrin, we know more about the condition of the world and everybody around us and what they post on social media and what we hear now. We're becoming inundated with Christmas cards. In amidst all that change, the only one constant is that God never changes. In fact, the song, Great is Thy Faithfulness, what do you think? Should we start off with a song?
Sure.
Okay, here we go. This is my morning voice, so I'll be able to hit the bass voice verses very well. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Isn't that amazing? And those words go through my heart. There's no shadow of turning with thee. You change not. Your compassions, they fail not. As you have been, you forever will be. And this writer of that hymn got it just right. So let's pray that God will help us to see what the writer of that hymn saw and what these men of scripture, which we're going to read, saw, that God never changes. Father, thank you for being a rock in the midst of a swirling storm and lots of currents and lots of changes, and yet you are steadfast. You remain. You are eternal. You're the great I am. Help us to get a grasp of that. Help us to anchor our souls to that truth today. Help me as I teach. Give us all ears to hear what you have for us along this line today. But let us assimilate it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So first of all, God tells us this several times. He introduced himself to Moses in Exodus chapter 3 when he said, I am who I am, which is just a great sentence, and we could probably spend half of eternity just meditating on the fact that God is. He's not evolving. He's not slowing down and deteriorating. He's not improving. He is. He is the perfect God who does not have to change, who just simply is. I am who I am. And then he reminds us in the last book of the Old Testament, in the book of Malachi, I, the Lord, do not change. Now, when I read those words, I think about when I was in seminary and you read about these different thoughts about God, that somehow he changed from the beginning of Isaiah to the end of Isaiah. It seems like there was two different beings. And many people have said that in the Old Testament, we have this God of vengeance. In the New Testament, we have the loving Jesus. And you and I know, because we've read the whole book many, many times, God does not change. He's a God of grace from the book of Genesis. He's a God of grace in the book of Revelation. He doesn't change. Jesus tapped into that when he said this next sentence that I'm going to read. The people that were listening knew because he pushed one of their buttons. Jesus said to them in John 8:58, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. And that just caused all kinds of consternation. How, you're a young man. You're from Nazareth. We know your mom and your dad. And you said, now, before Abraham was, I am. And he picked that word, ego me, which we've talked about in the previous podcast, I am, which identified him with God in Exodus 3. I am who I am. The writer of Hebrews affirms this truth in 13:8. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. And the same thought is expressed in Revelation. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. So we have these verses, and I hope that the verses, though, well, it's God's word, so it's living and it's active, and I don't have to expound upon it too much. These are just facts of the case. And then Paul writes, by the Spirit's inspiration in Colossians chapter 1, speaking of Jesus, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Whenever I want to meditate on Christ, I usually choose Colossians. That is first chapter. It's just powerful stuff. And then there's this next verse, which is really the inspiration for the hymn. I should have read it already. For great is thy faithfulness. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. No shadow, no variation, no changing. He's the Father of lights. Okay, so Scott, I'm going to give you a second here. Your adrenaline is starting to pump right now. Your blood pressure.
Yes.
So tell me some of your favorite portions of scripture that you look forward to hearing, listening to, reading? Because I know you use the audio Bible. Mm-hmm. So in the Old Testament, where are some favorite passages that you know when you're coming up to them, you're thinking, oh, good, I like this part?
Psalm 23 is an easy favorite, and I feel like I'm copping out by saying that, but I do love that one. And there are a bunch of other psalms. Anything that talks about his steadfast love endures forever.
So the Psalms, yeah, wonderful. One of my sections will surprise you. That's probably why I ask you that question, just to get everybody thinking that's listening. What are some of the favorite passages that you look forward to reading? And one of mine is the Isaiah 40s, like Isaiah 40 through 49. There are just some powerful stuff in there. I'm going to read four passages, but this is Isaiah, who saw the Lord high and lifted up. He had a vision of God. He saw in Isaiah chapter 6, powerful stuff, wonderful things. He saw God. And I think of that when I read these things, because he wasn't just writing something that he hoped for. These were truths. Isaiah 41:10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Isaiah 43. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me, no God was formed, nor shall there be any after me. It's as if God is just, he just kind of cast off the, all these false truths that are swirling about. And he just declares, hey, I'm your dad. I'm your God. I will uphold you. And hey, look around. There's no God before me. There's no God going to come after me. I am he. And then in Isaiah 44:6, he says, thus says the Lord, the King of Israel and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. I am the first and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. Isaiah 46:9, I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will accomplish all my purpose. It's a glimpse of a powerful God that we love. And we're glad we're on his team, because he can clear the air really fast. And yes, he came as in the form of a baby. We're entering into the Christmas season as we're recording this. And he humbled himself and he left his throne. But every once in a while, he just kind of shucks off the bathrobe, so to speak, and says, hey, don't forget, I am. And I am the first, I am the last, and there is no other God beside me. And the psalmist saw this in Psalm 102. Of old, you laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you will remain. They will all wear out like a garment. You will change them like a robe, and they will pass away. But you are the same, and your years have no end. And the concept of eternity for people that are born in a specific time in history, and we know we have 70 years perhaps, and maybe 80, and we know our finiteness, and yet God is infinite. It's hard to grasp this. And yet, as I read these words, it makes me think, well, if God is eternal and God is unchangeable, then so is his word. Psalm 33:11 says, the counsel of the Lord stands forever, the plans of his heart to all generations. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Matthew 24, very much in sync with passages that we read before. Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly fixed in the heavens. Psalm 119. And then 1 Peter 1, which is quoting Isaiah, you've been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers, the flower falls, but the word of the Lord remains forever. So when we have God's word, and we have God's promises, and we have God's declarations, we can count on them, because not one word he has spoken will ever be broken. I am the Alpha and the Omega. My word is fixed in the heavens, and everything around us is going to fade and perhaps be burned up. However, God remains the same. Whew, I feel like I'm preaching here. I'm preaching to myself as much as anybody. It's nice to hold on to this.
Preach it, brother.
Okay, so should we close with a song then?
Sure.
Maybe you know this song. It's written by A.B. Simpson, who was the founder of the Christian Missionary Alliance. It's one of my favorite songs. I don't know that I'm going to sing it, but I'll at least read the first verse and the refrain. Oh, how sweet the glorious message simple faith may claim. Yesterday, today, forever, Jesus is the same. Still, he loves to save the sinful, heal the sick and lame, cheer the mourner, still the tempest, glory to his name. And then the chorus. Yesterday, today, forever, Jesus is the same. All may change, but Jesus never. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. All may change, but Jesus never. Glory to his name.
Hallelujah.
Have you sung that song?
Oh, probably at some point. We haven't done regular hymns in a long time, so
yeah, they're like my meat and drink.
Yeah.
On a day that's not, you know, where life doesn't enter in too much, I like to start off by, I pull up a hymn book, which I have as a PDF on my computer. It's the Hymns for Family Worship, and I like to find one to start, and I like that one. So I'll just sing the chorus for you. Yesterday, today, forever, Jesus is the same. All may change, but Jesus never. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. All may change, but Jesus never. Glory to his name. And awesome, sometimes, man, when I sing to myself, or if nobody's home, I sing out loud or sing in the car. It just, that continues, that refrain just continues to go over and over in my spirit and my mind. And I find myself singing it throughout the day. So that's going to be my takeaway for the day, just to hold on to that all may change, but Jesus never.
That's one of those like spiritual disciplines, if you want to call it that, that I haven't ever really gotten into. And I, every time I hear you sing one of these, or I hear the words to, or read the words to a hymn, I think I should do that, because it is so edifying and inspiring, and it does build my hope to hear those words, you know, and the tunes help too. It's just, I grew up in a church where they did hymns, and then got away from churches where they do hymns, and I never got into the practice of singing them. So most of them I remember at one point having sung, but I never really memorized that many of them.
Well, Elizabeth Elliot said, I heard her tell me this, that it was phrases from hymns that got her through the most dark days of her life. Yeah. And then I found this quote recently of hers that says, hymns will get you through the night. I like that, because I personally don't like songs that are kind of in a minor key. I like upbeat major key. you know, bump, 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 instead of. So I like the fact that most hymns are in a major key and they're upbeat and they're strong and they're declaring truth. And I need to not only have these vehicles so that I can worship God, because you notice I said there 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 times in just the first verse and in the chorus, glory to his name. And so it's a vehicle for praise, but it's also an implement for, you might say, preaching the truth to myself. Amen.
If they ever start locking us all up for our faith, you're going to be the one that, you know, everybody that's in the jail with you is going to be looking to lead them in worship with all the hymns that you know.
Amen.
I'm afraid I'm going to be sitting there going, I don't remember anything.
Well, you know, it's nice to sing Amazing Grace about 100 times, but it's nice if you have some variety.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, let's pray. Father, thank you for songs and for truths, but thank you that here we are, finite beings, and you have opened our eyes, and we see you. And we see you as our Savior and as our Lord, and that's nothing but the work of God. And for that, we thank you. And we do bring glory to your name, and we do affirm your unchangeableness, that all around us, everything's going to change, but you remain the same. You are the one constant with a capital C, and we worship you and pray that you'll help each of us to get this rocky thing right down deep in our heart. So when the storms do come, we'll be hitched to a rock that can't change. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email steve at spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.